Hello, my fellow resistance fighters, and welcome to a very special episode of the Nomads of Fantasy. That's right, we've hit a great milestone. This is episode 69.
It's a long time.
That is a long time. It's a lot of episodes. I have with me tonight Admiral Dave.
Let's go, Chrome Dome.
And Commander Brandon.
I want every gun that we have to fire on that man.
And I am General Eric, and I will be hosting this episode of the Nomads of Fantasy. And if you didn't recognize those quotes, they are from the 2017
movie
film movie film
cinematic experience.
I don't know where I was going with that. I was trying to say like the eighth episode in the Star Wars Skywalker saga, The Last Jedi. A lot of divisive thoughts on this movie. We wanted to do this one because I know even among the Nomads there are some differing opinions. And we will certainly get into that. But first, we reached out on social media just to see what other people thought of this movie. Just because we know that it's so divisive, we wanted to get some other people's thoughts. So I have some here that I wanted to read as well. So Seismic Cinema says, loved it in the cinema, but the more I thought about the plot and the logic of some of it, the more I started to dislike some parts of it. E.g. the slow bombers, super slow bombers, etc. Visually looks great and really well acted, but feel like a lot that was being set up in The Force Awakens got wasted.
It's all these sequels are just independent films that have nothing to do with each of us.
All right. We'll get into it. Don't worry. our good buddy Jake says, when it comes to anything Star Wars, I'm along for the ride. Mm-hmm. Every major franchise has ups and downs, but even then, I'm going to enjoy the content to its fullest. Love this movie. Love the sequel trilogy. Hell, I just love anything Star Wars.
Sure.
Right.
I mean, that right there. That How is what every all Star Wars, Star Wars fan
fans should be. You know what I'm saying?
That's right. Jake is just a Not shining all Star Wars example.
Films are created equal, though. Series has ups and downs, but this movie, like, every 5 minutes was an up or a down.
Can it's you all just over. Behave it's all over there?
It's all
right.
Over.
You can't keep it. Can't. We have a whole act for us.
This is for, yes, this is the warm up here, the intro.
Act one is for the fans.
For the listeners. This is the kilted one says, I find overall it was a good movie. While it did have its issues, Casino World, I'm looking at you, I give credit for trying to be more of an original story than the other two. Some comfy parts did not work for me, like Finn in the leaky bubble suit, and let's not talk about Leia Pippins.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Poppins. I'm sure we will. I gotcha.
She did, yeah, okay. He did say Pippins. Okay. We'll get into that. And finally, Cody says, I didn't like it walking out. I didn't like it after The Rise of Skywalker. I still don't like it. As Paul from Seismic Cinema said, there's too much setup in The Force Awakens, completely ignored. Maybe I'd have different feelings about the film if we'd have gotten a I don't know what DOTF as the sequel means. Kind of doubt it, though.
Dawn of the Force. I don't know what DOTF is.
Me neither. But anyways, good points. I mean, it seems overall
it's divided
on Twitter anyways. It is. Yeah, it's definitely divided. Yep. Which, again, I think we are as well. But let's take a break. I think we're all itching to get into it. So we will get into it right after we come back.
Thank you.
are back to talk about The Last Jedi. It's weird. It's not... I mean, we... All of us love Star Wars so much. But it's not often that we really talk about it on our show. I mean, we've done... We talk about it a decent amount. We've done Revenge of the Sith.
Our second episode was on Star Wars. But, Star Wars episode.
Yes. Episode number 2. Please don't go back and listen to that one. Where we ranked our movies. Yeah, that is the, if you want to hear our rankings for our Star Wars movies, but that's a rough one to go back to. But I mean, we've talked about Solo, we've talked about Boba Fett and Obi-Wan, but the only
visions,
but the only, we've only done three. One of the Skywalker saga so far, and that is Revenge of the Sith episode 3. So this is our second mainline, if you want to call it that, Star Wars movie that we've talked about. So it is a little bit exciting when we get to talk about one of the big ones, you know, even if all parties don't love it as much as some other people
do. Hey, this is Star Wars. In 2022, this is Star Wars. You're going to have people who are going to have ones that they like and they don't like. This is the franchise, you know?
And we, and that's why
this is the movie.
That's why we picked everybody, this one. Like,
and every part of the sequel trilogy was like its own random, like, blindfolded throw at the dartboard. And some of them,
I mean, that's what happens when you have different directors. You got J.J. Abrams, Force Awakens, Ryan Johnson directing.
They had different
this one.
Directors back in the day, too. But
yeah,
it's
but
really just
they
the
were
prequels that had one director. It was George Lucas.
They were both, they were J.J. and Ryan Johnson. They were both trying to make it their own thing, and neither of their stories meshed together. Which I think
so
this,
weird.
I think The Last Jedi, maybe not. Well, it's arguably whatever. Maybe not the best one in the sequel trilogy. It's close, but the most experimental. I think.
Sure.
I think it's the most experimental film, like, in the Skywalker saga. You know,
it may be
1-9.
It may be the best looking film in all of the Skywalker saga. Like, it has got
100%
eye candy from start to finish.
Yeah, the cinematography was.
Eye candy is great.
This movie looks incredible.
You know, acting is, you know, decent for a Star Wars movie, but the story just is falls apart for me.
Well,
it's so fun to, like, look at, but then you see some of the things that people say and do, and you're like, what the fuck is going on here?
Like, I want to dig into that. I mean, I don't, we're not going to go, if you're listening to this, you've seen The Last Jedi. We're not going to go beat by beat through the plot. We'll go to the main plot points.
We're going
to
talk about this movie that's like 7 years later.
What I want to talk about is, yeah, how it fits into the larger Star Wars canon and the Skywalker saga, and what works about it and what doesn't. And I'm sure we will get into that.
Can I
say one thing besides it looking good? It also sounds good. Holy shit.
Dude,
that is true.
John Williams never disappoints ever. And this one, I forget, like, because I really like this movie and I really like how it looks. And I forgot, like, I also really like the music in this one.
Well, let me ask you this. I think I know the answers to this, but I think we all have different experiences with this movie. How did you... So we all saw this when it first came out, right? In theaters.
Yes.
How did you feel walking out of it the first time that you saw it?
I personally walked out thinking that it was one of the best Star Wars movies. I know, like, I always will hold A New Hope as the best. And right after that is Empire Strikes Back. But I didn't enjoy Rogue One. I didn't really enjoy 1, 2, and 3. So, and 7 was okay. It just was very similar to 4 to me. And I thought 8 was just like, all right, we're back on track now. You know, it's more unique. Like, I don't need a retelling of 4. I already have 4. You're the number 7. I already have 4. So don't redo 4. Please. I don't know why you did that. So, like, I have problems with, like, the story of 7. And this one, I never knew what to expect. And that's what I liked about Empire Strikes Back. Like, I think the story's going to go one way, but it doesn't. And it's all about that failure and stuff like that. So I walked out of it like, it's the middle one. It's the middle child. And the middle one's got a unique role. And episode 2 was I think, arguably the worst Star Wars movie in the entire saga. So I came out of 8 like amped. I was like, holy shit. The young guy with the Force is now running the show. Like, that's cool. Like, the old, it's not like an old guy this time. They had Snoke and they killed off Snoke. Like, holy shit. It's Kylo Ren's going to run the show? Because I was really into Snoke. And I was like, this is great. So I was amped. I was ready to go to 9. And plot twist, I didn't like 9.
Somehow,
really Palpatine disappointed me.
But we're, not talking about that. We're not talking about 9. I don't even want
to. But it's hard not to think about 9 when you're watching. You know, it's hard not to think about all those movies and TV shows when you watch a Star Wars movie today. So that's how I felt when I came out of it.
Okay. Dave, what about you?
I was more of like a meh. Like, the way they did Luke Skywalker in this one was, I don't think, was a great choice, because I don't know, we know him from the original series and he's like the hero, and there's all these movies and books and tons of comics written about how Luke is the hero. And this one, he was just a pouty little baby, and he was sulking in the corner, and he's just like, I want to die on this island. Wah. And then at the end, he did some cool Force projection stuff, and then he just poofed, disappeared. And I'm like, that's how you're going to let him go out of the series? It's just, eh, it was like a whisper. Like, I don't know. It was cool. The Force projection thing was kind of cool. It was all right. A lot of those parts didn't make sense too, because like, you can't touch Force Ghost Luke, but you can pick up the dice and hold them in your hands. Like, shit doesn't make sense all over this movie. There's like, 1 minute there'll be something that I'm like, damn, that is super cool. Like, that looks awesome. That sounds awesome. That was actually a funny line. And then 2 minutes later, I'm like, what the fuck are they doing? Why are they doing this? This makes no sense. Why am I supposed to care about this purple haired general that I just met like 2 minutes ago? Like, great, let her smash her way into the ship or whatever. And like, even they've gone back on those things where like, you can't go into hyperdrive and like smash a ship. Like, they've had to backtrack on that stuff because they're like,
I'm sorry, are we watching Star Trek or Star Wars? You're like going so fucking
matter.
Literal on this shit.
It doesn't
matter.
I was
thinking,
it's like, come
same,
on,
like,
there's fucking puppets. There's like, come on, Chewbacca pilots of a thing called Millennium Falcon. Like, look at that character. He looks,
and he's
ridiculous.
Got little chickens with him now as his like little comic relief buddies that he like.
You gotta have something for the kids.
You sound like the internet.
You gotta have merchandising.
No. There are things that are good in this movie. Like, you know, I don't mind the Finn Poe. I don't mind the casino planet. It's cool to see other planets in this universe where like, you know, you get to build out. Yeah, you get to build out the universe. You get to see other stuff. It's not, you know, it's not a pointless trip. People always say, bring that up. Like, they went
sounds
to
like,
the planet for nothing, but
it
they
like
got
Luke
the code breaker.
It sounds like Luke is the thing. That's your big issue. Because if you like Canto
Bight,
like
the Luke and Rey stuff, I really did like. Like, their interactions with them, like the little training sessions they had, the stuff on, I forget the name of that planet, the little island planet. You know, it was all right. Like, Luke going from the hero of the galaxy to a crusty old bearded man drinking like manatee tit juice.
All right, hold on. Let's not get ahead of ourselves. Hold on.
I know that's like, we haven't seen that before. Obi-Wan Kenobi. You would have. Sorry, guys.
Right. They drank.
Fucking,
they
were
drank
like,
from the tea.
Dude, no, going with crusty old fucking angry, bitter, sad, leave me alone.
All right. Hold up,
exile.
Hold up.
No.
Before
Yoda
we get
went,
into specifics, stop.
All right, let's.
Before we get into specifics and lose track here.
I know. So how did you feel when you came out of seeing this one?
I've had an interesting ride with this movie, an experience with this movie.
Oh, really?
Well, I walked out of the theater the first time I saw it. Much like Dave, like, I walked out pretty meh on this movie. I was like, I feel like I just watched it, didn't really absorb everything that was happening. And I think I was a little bit disappointed because I was so high off of Force Awakens. Like, I was so excited to see what comes next after that. Because, like, I mean, you can listen to our Star Wars episode if you want. But I rank Force Awakens pretty high. It's higher up there. It's not my favorite or anything, but it's definitely in there, like top 4, I would say. So I was super excited when this movie was coming out. And I think some of the points that some of the people on Twitter made is that The Force Awakens kind of set up a lot of things and set up a precedent where The Last Jedi diverged a lot from the direction that that was going. So I think I walked out the first time. I was, you know, not as high on it. I was a little bit disappointed about what I watched. But over time, the more I watched it, the more I thought about it, the more I sort of analyzed what was going on and, you know, the greater Star Wars canon that, you know, it kind of involves, I've started liking it a lot more. So, like, I feel like with each subsequent watch, I like it more and more, you know? So now it is definitely up there with some of my favorites as well. So, I mean, I've had a bit of a journey with this one. Like, I think at face value, I thought that it was a bit of a disappointment. There was some cool scenes. But the more I watch it, the more I think about it, I'm like, wow, this movie...
The more it doesn't make sense.
This movie took some chances, took some risks, done some things that I've never seen anyone else do in a Star Wars movie before. And, you know, I thought it worked very well. And I think it works better, like we have been saying, as a standalone movie. Forget episode 7 and forget episode 9. Just focus on what happens in this movie. Because, I mean, this story is self-contained. The story is very simple.
Fairly, you know. Well,
the whole entire story is the Resistance basically just running away from the Empire, just trying to survive.
The Resistance,
from the First Order.
Issue number one, right there. Boom.
What?
They're the Resistance. They're resisting. The First Order, like, just got there and just blew up, like, 5 planets. Like, they're not the Resistance. They're the fucking Republic. Like, they're the government.
The Republic's gone, dude.
They blew up a couple planets. Like, you blew up Florida, New York, and California. The rest of the fucking United States is still here. It is still the Galactic Republic.
I feel like they blew up, like, Washington, D.C.
Whatever. It's still
And you're watching Hawaii kind of figure out what's going on.
No. They blew up, like, what, 5 planets? So you have an entire Galactic Republic. And then all of a sudden you blow up a couple planets and now, we only have 2 ships left and we're the only people like in the entire...
No, not necessarily.
There should be thousands of planets
there
in the Republic.
At the end, they send out a distress signal to all of these planets, but nobody answers. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So they are the last of the Resistance. Like, they are the only ones fighting against the First Order. They're the only ones left.
The Force Order came out of the Outer Rim, or out of the unknown sector where they were hiding there for whatever. They made Starkiller Base. Starkiller Base blew up a couple planets. They blew up their planet. And then all of a sudden, it doesn't make sense in, like, the greater scheme of things. It's like if
we could blow up the Death Star twice.
Yeah.
Right? And that's... Okay, so the Empire still comes back.
That's the exact thing I'm saying.
It's like, this is the world. There's more bad people who want convenience.
You can't blow up a couple planets and then the Republic is just gone. Like,
well, that's
the same exact thing that you're saying. The Empire is still there. You can't blow up a couple planets and the Republic.
I mean, maybe they're not fleshing it out as much, but I feel like after they did that, the First Order asserted their dominance and the Republic just crumbled to the First Order. Like, they're not fighting against the First Order. The only people that are fighting against the First Order are this band of Resistance fighters. Like,
there is probably thousands of Republic bases out there and outposts. It's like as you blow up a couple states.
You're just assuming.
You still have Luke and Leia, after they blew up the second Death Star, they've had decades of no Empire to restore the galaxy.
I think they've grown complacent, though, Dave. I think they're like not active anymore. And the rest of them are like, no, like the First Order is still, we got to stop this and do something about it.
Yeah. It's like,
and Luke's gone. Like the hope, like the fire, all that, the whole theme of this movie is just like, there's nothing driving them. There's just no like fire in anybody anymore, except this small group of people that lays around. It's like, these are the people who are actually doing something about it. They're a smaller.
There's a
team.
Universe, and then
you know, like the give you like think about there's this. Like the Empire is one idea. There's one idea on how to rule the galaxy, and it's under the Empire's rule with Vader underneath him. That's one idea. But everybody else is like, when you say that's not the right way. So everybody else is like, it's like countries across like the planet, right? It's just everybody has their own view of like how they we should run like the universe. It's just not how the Empire wanted to do it. So now you get the First Order, one general, a very aggressive idea, and everybody else is just kind of doing their own thing. Leia is just part of one sector of all these different people's ideas of what it is to have like peace. Because the Empire thinks that, he was bringing peace and balance to the Empire just with aggressive.
The Star Wars universe is bigger, like you were saying, Dave. There's like the Outer Rim. The Outer Rim doesn't abide by, you know,
they kind of do
the Republic. They don't have the First Order. And, you know, I don't know where this is. The Mid Rim, I guess. I don't know if it's the Inner Rim. I don't know. Whatever. Wherever it is. This is where the Galactic Republic is, you know, this is where they are holed up, and this is where the First Order is rising up. So, yes, there is a bigger universe out there. So it is a smaller, it's on a smaller scale. Like, I don't think the First Order doesn't have control over the entire galaxy, you know, like the Empire did. The First Order is nowhere near as big as the Empire was, you know. Because
exactly. That's exactly. The First Order is not very big. Like, I don't know. I didn't think they had that many Star Destroyers, but apparently they had a pile of them with them. But we all saw the prequels. We all saw how big the Republic is, how many hundreds and hundreds of planets were in the Republic, how many thousands
they're
of ships
still rebuilding it, though, changed. After the Empire.
After 60 yes. years.
Yeah. Well, no, that you was know? The end of that was the end of the war. You know, things just don't disappear, but there are that many planets in the Galactic Republic.
Need to watch Star Trek to get that, because they're way bigger. I mean, like, we're talking about a movie series that's about, like, three friggin' families, right?
Yeah.
Not even two families, you know? Well, three if you throw the Solos in there. You know, like, that's, like, the joke. That's what this movie's meta about. Like, and there's a whole layer about, like, this movie is very, like, meta about what it is to be a Star Wars movie, you know.
Well, yeah, and they overkill on the hype or the hope points, and we are the spark and blah blah blah. And it feels like they didn't earn the Rebels versus Empire that was set up earlier. They just kind of forced their way into it. Like, there was
They have a killer intro battle. I think it's stupid that like one TIE fighter can crash into the bombers and they all get wiped out.
I don't know what you're talking about. This is the same as the original trilogy. Like, it's the Force Awakens. I mean, Force Awakens is basically a mirror of Episode 4, like we said. It sets up the same exact conflict between the First Order and the Resistance that it did with the Empire and the Rebels. And then in Empire Strikes Back, you start right in the middle of the war between the Empire and the Rebels. When Darth Vader's trying to find the Rebel base on Hoth, it's the same exact thing. I don't know why you're complaining so much about it.
That one, you have a full Empire under galactic rule, and you have like an underground ragtag group of people. Like, the Empire's been in control for 20, 30 years, about the same amount that the
I don't
Republic
know how much any
control.
Of that matters to this movie specifically, though.
Like, I'm just saying that the Empire, they're forcing the Rebels versus the Empire kind of thing in there. I don't know. They're not Rebels. It's the Republic.
That's why I try to look at this movie as like a standalone movie experience.
Yeah.
Outside of like, that's why I think that's how I look at it. And that's why I like it so much. Ignoring all of the other stuff that got set up in The Force Awakens and that came after it. But this movie by itself, I think, as a self-contained story, there are some parts that are divisive, but
sure.
As a right. self-contained story, I think it is good and it makes sense.
Okay. Sure. Some parts make sense. Some parts are completely idiotic. Like, I don't know. There's a lot of humor in this movie that I don't think.
That's the Marvel Disney thing that they're trying to work on.
I don't mind the
humor.
That's
the thing,
though.
I didn't
like any of the humor in 1, 2, and 3. I thought they were made for kids. I didn't laugh at one thing. I was more like, the action's cool, though. I think that's... I mean, whatever. People fucking pick on Disney all the time because they're like, they go a little bit overboard. But I actually like him. I think it was funny.
You like it?
Shows up and he sees
Hux. I think that's funny.
I thought it was funny.
When the drunk guy puts coins into BB-8 and he uses them as like a coin dispenser to shoot guards.
Yeah, dude. Are you kidding me? Like, what are you watching Star Wars
Star
for?
Star Wars
you
is can't silly.
For fucking yeah. lightsaber silly, fights bro. And force shit and
don't
dark
take
side
your Star Wars so seriously.
I know.
No, it's not that the original trilogy had like
so many rules for you to enjoy Star Wars. I think that's your problem.
No, there was a charm to the original ones. Like they were kind of like witty. Like, I don't know. They didn't have like this, like the humor in this was just kind of like,
it's a 3 second scene, dude. Are you kidding me? Like this is what you want to talk about? You want to bring that up?
All over. Hold on. The phone call in the very beginning of the movie, the I'll hold for Hux line.
Yeah, that was funny.
That was funny.
That was, and there was a purpose to it too, because he was trying to stall and delay, you know, so he could line up his attack. Communicate for
General Hux. Patch him through. This is General Hux of the First Order. The Republic is no more. Your fleet are rebel scum and war criminals. Tell your precious princess there will be no terms. There will be no surrender.
Hi, I'm holding for General Hux.
This is Hux. You and your friends are doomed. We will wipe your filth from the galaxy.
Okay, I'll hold.
Hello?
Hello? Yep, I'm still here.
Can he hear me?
Hux?
He can.
With an H, skinny guy, kind of pasty.
I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Look, I can't hold forever. If you reach him, tell him Leia has an urgent message for him.
I believe he's tooling with you, sir.
About his mother.
Listen, you're under orders to go blow up the rebels, and you're gonna sit there and take a fucking phone call and get pranked for 30 seconds while...
He thought he was coming in to say surrender.
No, you're
That's
there
what
to
he
blow...
was saying in the call.
He's there to kill everybody. He always said, he talks about scum, and we're gonna kill you, and we're gonna crush you, and man, 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 and Hux does his whole little speeches, and then he'll sit there and get made of an ass of himself, and then an X-Wing is going to fly and destroy an entire ship, even though...
He's the best pilot in the galaxy.
Half an hour later, like, you have shields on ships. And what's the Dreadnought doesn't have shields on it? Like...
So Luke is 17 years old. He wants to be a pilot.
Sure.
And goes around fucking shooting people out of the sky at the end of of A New Hope.
Yeah.
Right? 3 weeks later, he's wearing, like, fucking, I don't know, a wife beater, and he's hopping around the swamp, right, with Yoda on his back, right? And he's able take on Vader with a lightsaber. And then, the third one, he's wearing, like, a black turtleneck, like, kind of One Piece thing, and he's, like, a Jedi Master. And, like,
well, that's like a 10-year gap.
We've seen this before. It's why is it not allowed that these new characters are not allowed to also be awesome and just be good at what they do? He's the best pilot in the galaxy. If there's one person who's going to do it, it's going to be Poe Dameron.
Sure.
Dude, how cool is that fucking shit? I thought it was stunning. I was like, this is what I signed up
for. It was visually stunning. Yes.
But you guys talked about episode 3, how awesome it was watching like Luke... And I'm sorry, Luke. Anakin and Obi-Wan.
Yeah, the opening
zipping
scene
around.
Of
and I thought this was reminiscent.
Yeah, awesome.
Like
very
this is
reminiscent.
This is what I like in my Star Wars intros. This is like one of the characters showing how fucking cool they are in outer space on a ship, and he's the man. He's got BB-8 with him. I don't know.
It
blows me away that you don't like that, but you'll accept it with others.
So if the joke wasn't in there, you would have liked the scene that much more.
Like that Poe was able to go and take out, like, turrets.
Well, no, it doesn't make sense that, you know, you can fly through...
What about the Death Star? They flew through a fucking trench. It's the same thing.
No.
Yeah, it's the same exact
Return
thing.
Of the Jedi, they had to, you know, that ship had...
Okay, well, Death Star has shields. New Hope, they could easily just fly through a trench and take out
30
their turrets
later,
as well.
30 minutes later, the shields are saving them up. It's a nitpicky, dumb thing. I just ignore I even said it, but it's... The joke in the beginning, like the humor throughout the movie was just kind of silly, and it didn't.
Some
it
of the
didn't
humor didn't land.
To...
I'll give you that. The Finn in the stupid medical bag leaking all over the place. It was dumb.
But really, I don't even see it. I see it and I move on. Like I don't even see the issue.
It was like, fine. It's just like it's not like it's didn't take away from it's the experience for me.
Back the tank, but it's like on him. Like the
technology. I thought it was cool like, technology. It was just kind of silly. Like there should be a medical droid there, and it should be stopping him from leaving.
Why does it have to be a medical droid there? Why does it have to be one?
Because it's a ship with medical droids on it. Like
they don't need one. They also like
the
a
technology is
team,
advanced
like,
also. So
that was cool to see.
They don't need them anymore.
I don't know. I think if you go to this movie demanding things have to be there, then you're like this movie. I think is what makes people frustrated.
That's why I like this movie because they shook up a lot of things in the Star Wars formula.
That's all I asked for.
Yeah,
and I think in a fun way, not like Episode One where they brought in politics and like boring shit. You know, this was actually exciting. They're on the run.
I mean, the action in this movie is killer. It's top notch. It's some of the best in Star Wars films. Period. You know,
wait, well, there's like. Not a lot of action in this movie.
Sure there is.
There is a lot of action. It's just a 2.5 hour movie.
Yeah, that's true. It was a very long movie. There's a lot of
I always think about how this one's not action, and I'm like, I forget that this movie ends with a big fight scene. It starts with a big fight scene.
One of the best lightsaber fight scenes in Star Wars, you know.
It was well choreographed. It was very
and
visually
the thing
stunning.
I like about it is they change it up a lot from the prequel trilogy. Like their lightsaber fighting style, you can tell Rey and Kylo Ren are both very sloppy and untrained. They're fighting with like emotion. In like the prequels, obviously Obi-Wan and Anakin are like Jedi masters and they have like these advanced choreographed lightsaber routines and fights, but like Rey and Kylo, they're just swinging a lightsaber around.
Well, Rey, Kylo looks like he knows what he's doing.
Like, yeah, but he's not like dancing. He's not like dance fighting like they were. And he's like raw emotion just slashing his lightsaber around.
Well, the guy that trained him is also new it. He's like a new manager, right? I mean, like, it's like Luke also is like by himself. So, like, yeah, that's designed on purpose in Star Wars.
No, I like, yeah, I like that.
It's very like, let's just get the job done. Like, don't kill yourself with this thing.
No, but that's one thing that I noticed though, that like just the lightsaber, like the fighting styles are different from what you normally see in a Star Wars movie.
I want to say this. I knew I was really going to like this movie after the attack on the dreadnought. I thought cinematically it was stunning. I thought the music was really cool. I liked how confident that the New Order, the First Order was. And when they finally did get the bombers to show up with characters like Paige in there, it was like all done with music. And I thought the pacing was done well. I was invested. I actually was kind of not emotionally connected to that Paige character, but the importance of everybody's role was laid out in the first, like, I don't know, 10 minutes of this movie. And I was like, I get it. You know, like, these are dire straits. They're on the run. They don't have much to go off of. They keep losing stuff. And I was invested at that time.
It's a galactic, they're a galactic republic that has two ships.
Oh my God.
it's silly. Let's be honest.
If they're not, this is not the entire galactic republic. We can't rehash this again. All
right. If there was more ships, away. They would have come right there because Leia's their leader. So,
but the whole point is, at the end of the movie, Leia sends out a distress message with her code and nobody answers. Nobody believes in her anymore. That's the entire point of the movie. Mm-hmm. All hope is lost and you have to find a way to continue to fight for what you love. That's like the entire thing about this movie.
It's a little ham-fisted, yeah, sure.
Well, but it explains all your issues. We're like, where's the rest of the Republic? And like,
nobody believes in them anymore.
It's a Republic. Belief doesn't matter. If you're the fucking leader and you say come, the rest of the Galactic Republic comes.
What? A galaxy?
Yeah. They all got the messages.
Dude,
they're
gonna
be
along in this country, let alone the state, let alone this town.
And
you're expecting
Leia's
Leia
also
to
not
have
the leader.
Galaxy?
Leia's a general. She's not like the fucking chancellor or anything. She's a general.
Right. I don't even know what the leader of the Republic is called these or who. I guess they probably got blown up.
Exactly. Whoever was the leader. Exactly. So the Republic is broken. It's crumbled at this point. And again, all hope is lost. And
I thought the leader was blown up on the planet.
Exactly. Yes. In
the Last Awakens. They targeted that one because that's where they were having a gala and they had a lot of officials there and they blew them out of the sky. or something.
It
like
was
that.
Just it was just rich people looking up at the sky at a comet. That's all it was.
Is that true though?
I mean, it was probably an important planet.
Why would they show that when? Well, I don't know. Well,
I'm sure
we have to go. Okay, we should go back and watch The Force Awakens because I'm pretty sure like those planets that they wiped out were the like Republic, and there's no more. I mean, not no
you
more.
Can,
but
you
like,
can blow up a couple planets, but that doesn't mean there's not 1,000 other ships that belong to
okay,
the Republic.
We
got to
get off this point. We got to get off this point.
Yeah, I don't know.
I've made
I think
my
you're
points.
Being a dead horse. Yeah.
Keep going. Keep going. We'll talk about laser swords. We can talk
let's
about.
Let's talk about yeah. Let's talk about Luke a little bit since you hated him so much in this movie.
No, I like the Luke and Leia or the Luke and Rey
you
stuff.
Said in the beginning, you hated him.
I didn't like how they treat like how Luke is a scared little coward that's hiding on a planet.
It's the Jedi way. Yoda
you can't
did
say
it.
It's
Obi-Wan
the same as
it.
Yoda. You can't
Yoda
say it's
it.
The same
Obi-Wan
as Yoda.
It.
No. Yoda was hiding for his life from like the Sith and the entire Empire.
Obi-Wan did the same
thing. So is Luke.
Luke is not. No, Luke had a couple.
He's not
his,
hiding.
He had a couple of his kids killed. His little Jedi Academy failed, and he had
and
his
nephew
feelings.
Is the most nephew and
Kylo Ren
had his
dominating the
hurt.
Galaxy.
When has Luke ever been afraid of anybody?
If when Kylo Ren could have if Kylo Ren could have found him, he would have killed him. But he couldn't find him because he was in hiding.
Maybe.
The last fight at the end with Luke's force projection, did you see how mad Kylo was and the hate he had in his eyes for Luke?
Yeah.
He was out to kill him. And
sure.
he was looking for him this entire time, but
yeah,
he couldn't
no,
find him.
I'm saying he could have tried to kill Luke, but I don't know if he would have succeeded if he found him.
And same
are
with
you
Yoda,
kidding
same
me?
With Obi-Wan.
Wait a minute,
it's
hold on a second.
Thing.
Hold on a second. You don't think that Kylo Ren could take out Luke Skywalker when he's 70 years old?
He's not 70. He's got to be
65.
What? Yeah, he's probably pretty old.
Bro, he's old.
Yeah,
he's old.
He's old. What do you want him to do? Like be like Yoda and bounce around? When Kylo shows up with like 50 ships and Snoke's there, like what's Luke gonna do?
I'm talking about this is like a decade or two later after he's well no it's probably like a good
look what? At Obi-Wan Kenobi
Obi-Wan
in A New Hope he's
and
old
Yoda
fuck.
Yoda
hi-
Yoda went into hiding away. Yoda went into hiding because he lost to Darth Sidious and
yes.
He was ashamed and he went
and,
into hiding.
I don't think that's why he went into hiding.
Yes,
because he would have just
it's
gotten,
the Jedi way. It's kind of it's like it's like samurai.
Jedi ways to go hide,
dude. This Jedi. No.
Yeah,
are,
dude, you never noticed this theme.
Jedi are
no.
Thing.
It's not
yes.
a thing where they go.
They're
hide.
Too proud. That's you. Luke makes a very good point in this movie.
Jedi are based Jedi off samurai. They, when samurai are shamed, they kill themselves. This
right.
is the same thing. When Jedi are shamed
so.
And they lose and they fail, they go into hiding. That
they,
is,
they're just trying to not die.
That, no,
they're doing
not
whatever
of
they
dying.
Can. To, they're doing whatever they can to. Save them. So why would Yoda not just die then?
Because he
lost. He's trying to carry on the Jedi tradition and he's going to bide his time on a planet and just wait it out for a little bit.
Oh, really? Because like Luke shows up and he's like ready to learn and Yoda's like, no.
Yoda was exactly the same. Yoda turned into an old hermit that like completely abandoned the Jedi ways. Luke
right.
did the same
Obi-Wan
thing.
Obi-Wan Kenobi did the same thing in the TV show. Like, this is the theme. It's just like, no, like, don't
he's
do
doing it for his own protection. Not because he's ashamed or anything. It's because he doesn't want to die.
Okay, so
I
what do you want Luke to be
that.
Like, giving Rey a hug when she shows up? He's like a miserable man who's been living on an island.
He should be
and he's
part
got PTSD.
Of, part of the rebellion
he's got
with
so
his
much
sister.
Guilt. He's, his nephew is like this
so should Yoda. So should
probably,
Yoda. If that's,
probably.
If that's your logic, then Yoda should as well.
There was no rebellion then, though.
Yeah, what are you talking about? Yes, there was. The, that's
the
whole reason that Luke...
At the end of Revenge of the Sith,
there
was no rebellion.
There wasn't a
there were no
resistance.
Rebels for decades.
There wasn't a resistance when Luke went into hiding. Luke went into hiding after Kylo
yeah, there's destroyed a galactic, there's
the
a giant
Jedi
galactic
Temple.
Republic.
That's not the... What?
Okay, there's a giant galactic republic in this when, you know, Kylo went off. First Order didn't exist yet
exactly.
when Kylo ran off. So why is he going into hiding?
Because he was ashamed of his failure.
And he's just going to, if he's going to go there to die, he should just fucking die then.
That's what
not,
he did go there
that's
to
what
do.
That's what he was trying to do.
That's what he went there to do. And then
that's
why
he
wanted to do it.
Ray gives him the lightsaber.
Just
get this thing out of my hand. What are you doing?
Fucking
not,
turn
I'm
on a jet this. Engine in your own face and die then, Luke. Because
is that suicidal?
Yeah.
Well, He's just gonna go.
He just wants to go in isolation, and
that's silly.
Well, Dave, that's Star. I don't know if you, how are we arguing about this? This is like all Obi-Wan. Over Star Wars.
Listen,
this is all over Star Wars.
All right, we're getting stuck
he's
on
a hero of the galaxy, all right, and a hero of the Republic. Like
I thought this was really cool. So Luke is like telling Rey to go away, and then you hear bang, 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 bang in the door.
Go
he's
away.
Like, go away, and all of a sudden, boom, the door is smashed open, and I'm like, whoa. Like, Rey did that with force, but it was cheap.
Right, they make it, they do a little bait and switch there.
Yeah, and I like that they were doing like these cool, like, when you're getting, like, kind of catching up with what everybody's been up to, I like when they're like, okay, so Chewbacca's here with the Millennium Falcon, like, where's Han? And it transitions to Kylo Ren. You know, I like when Finn was just like, you know, like Poe's like, how you probably have like 1,000 questions, and Finn is just like, where's Rey? And it cuts to Rey. I like how where everybody keeps asking where people are, and then it edits like into that person.
I thought,
like,
that made it cheap.
I
want to see Luke's reaction to seeing Han died. I want to hear the story about Han died. And as I was grabbing a beer, I was thinking, we're saying that Luke's going into hiding because of this whole Kylo Ren thing. None of this happened in the first episode. All of this story was written for this episode. It didn't have to be like this. Kylo Ren could have been Kylo Ren any number of thousands of ways.
Yeah, that's how you make a story. What do you mean?
No, I know that. But the way that they wrote Luke into the story was to turn him into the weak hermit. Like, they didn't have to do that. Luke could have been any number of thousands of things in this movie. He could have been,
but he wasn't.
He could have been a general. He could have been anything.
Yeah. What's the point? What's your point?
That his portrayal in this movie kind of sucked.
I'm sorry. He's not. That's the whole message of this movie. When she shows up and says her line, they're like, "We need you." And he like repeats it like a couple times in this movie. It's like the franchise being spoken to him.
Also,
and he's
without
just like,
that,
I'm 70 years old. I have PTSD. I have failed. There's not much I can do. I gotta just hide and take like the ideology of the Jedi with me.
Without that, also without Luke being this hermit, whatever, we would have zero reason to care about Rey, and she would have no way to develop her character or to develop as a Jedi and learn what it means to be a Jedi.
He trained Kylo, and look how that worked out.
That was his own fault, though. Not Kylo's fault. His fault.
She's trying. No. Oh my God. Okay. So
that was Luke. That was all in Luke's head.
She literally says that it was not his fault.
Well,
it was
okay.
Ben's fault.
This is
Ben's problem.
We get the perspective. Says. We get the perspective from Luke, him telling the story that Kylo turned on him. We get the perspective from Kylo saying that Luke tried to kill him in his sleep. And then we get the real story. It's a combination of both.
Yeah.
Luke sensed
like
the darkness in Kylo. He had a moment of weakness where he turned his lightsaber on, and then Kylo, like, before he could fix his mistake, Kylo turned on him. Like,
do you blame him?
No, but...
No, you can't. So that's what I'm saying. You're not supposed to pick a side at the end of this movie. You're supposed to... Now you're really supposed to care. It's like in Empire Strikes Back. You didn't care about Vader in the first movie. He's just a fucking bad guy wearing a cape with a red lightsaber, and he's the bad guy. There's no story. You don't know he's Anakin. It's not written out yet. But the next movie, episode 6, you learn that Anakin Skywalker is Darth Vader. So now you care about him. You learn about who he is. He's Anakin Skywalker. Now you care about who the bad guy is. Okay, now that like you have different, like you have different,
well,
you go into that in episode 5
even, well,
differently than when you come out, because now you kind of care about Anakin.
You don't care,
you care
about him
Vader.
Because you just say that
he was once good.
You say that your father, no, all you know is that your father was murdered by Vader, and then at the end he says, I am your father.
Of four. Only in 4.
No, in 5,
your father was killed by...
We talked to Ghost Obi.
Obi-Wan Kenobi tells you in episode 4, New Hope, that Anakin Skywalker was your father, and he was killed by Darth Vader. And that's it. There's nothing else to that story. And you just think this is the bad guy and he killed Luke's father. All right, great. And then in the next movie, you learn that Anakin Darth Vader was Anakin.
You just know that Anakin's, you just know that Vader is his father. You don't know that Anakin and Vader are the
from,
same person.
That's what Brandon's, from episode four, you can make that connection. Because
how?
Obi-Wan before. Says, because you just said it.
Obi-Wan, said, and
Obi-Wan tells him person? That.
He just says he's killed by him. It is only up until episode five that we learn
and six,
that he's
he says,
the father.
And six, he says, that he from a certain point of view, six is when you learn that Anakin and Vader are the same person.
No. I'm trying to think. And no, because I am your father.
I am your father, yes. But you don't know that Anakin and Vader are the same person. You just know that he's the father. In six, you get Luke yelling at Force Ghost Obi-Wan saying, you know, why didn't you tell me that he was my father? And he,
that's
I thought
the
cleanup you said,
for four, but sure, fine, I guess. Yeah. I
like,
figured at that
sounds
point.
Sounds like an episode of Maury.
You are. But anyways, the there's more to Anakin's story. So now you care. I'm sorry, Vader. So you care about Vader as a character, I thought. Because at that moment, you learned that he, I thought, he's Anakin. And like you can see that he turned evil, yeah. Right? So now you're watching Last Jedi, which is the middle movie of the trilogy. And you don't really know what Ben did to turn evil, but now you learn about his story and like the whole connection. Like he's just really reaching out to Rey to get me out of this because mm-hmm. he keeps like doing bad things, like, you know, killing his father, you know, following Snoke, all that stuff. Which, even when he kills Snoke, he makes another bad decision, but like he keeps reaching out to Rey, and Rey is supposed to be like, you know, Ray of Hope or something like that. I don't know, but
I think Kylo Ren's character
conflict
is really,
it's
really
makes
good.
Sorry.
No, yeah. From like you said, Brandon, we learn a little bit of Kylo Ren's backstory, and you can tell he's conflicted throughout this entire movie. You know about what
Which
he
I,
did with.
It's really good.
Yeah, what he did with Han. Like he even goes back to Snoke saying, "Like I killed my father. I did. You know, I didn't hesitate in that moment. I, you know, he's trying to prove himself to Snoke." But
oh, I love that scene. Snoke's yeah. acting is so good, dude.
It is, circus.
It is really good. Yeah.
How's your wound?
It's nothing.
The mighty Kylo Ren. When I found you, I saw what all masters live to see. Raw, untamed power. And beyond that, something truly special. The potential of your bloodline. A new Vader. Now, I fear I was mistaken.
I've given everything I have to you. To the dark side.
Take that ridiculous thing off. Yes. There it is. You have too much of your father's heart in you, young son.
I killed Hanzo. When the moment came, I didn't hesitate.
And look at you. The deed split your spirit to the bone. You were unbalanced. Bested by a girl who had never held a lightsaber, you failed! Skywalker lives. The seed of the Jedi Order lives. As long as it does, hope lives in the galaxy. I thought you would be the one to snuff it out. Alas, you're no Vader. You're just a child. In a mask.
The only thing that I get that Snoke was portrayed as like going to be the big bad, like the stand-in for the Emperor. Which I did like that they subverted your expectations and they kill him like halfway through this movie.
Hey, you already have six movies with that going on. We don't need it again.
Right.
We've done that. Which watch I think 1-6 if you want to see that shit.
Or even 7. If you do kill Snoke in this one, you make Kylo the big bad of 9, not the Emperor.
I know. Like, I wanted that.
Right.
That's why I don't like 9.
Because, well, with the way this movie leaves off, because you have this point where Kylo is like, he let the past die. That's his whole thing. Forget about the past. Just come forward with me, Rey, and we'll create our own. We'll create a vision of the galaxy that we want to create. Not with Jedi, not with Sith, not with, the First Order, not with the Resistance.
And Luke's saying that in the same way. He's like, it's time for the Jedi to end. Mm-hmm. Because the Jedi, it's like vanity for the Jedi to think that they know how to balance the universe. Right? And the Sith are saying the same things. Like, you know, Kylo's saying, yeah, fuck them both. And so is Luke. It's like, no, like in his own way, it's just like, let's just like, it'll sort itself out. There, I was watching a deleted scene of this movie, and there was Luke and Rey are like out training, right, on the rocks and stuff like that. And he's looking at the end of the island, and you see fire in the village. He's like, "This happens once a month. The pirates in the area come to this island, and they pillage the small villages and stuff like that." Wow. And it's like those frog-like looking characters, right? The caretakers. So Rey's like, "Well, we got to do something." He's like, "No, nope." So it's like, well, you can though. Like, we'll just stop this. He's like, yeah, but if I do, then more will come next month. And if I take it, then it should be more and more and more. It just is endless. So it's actually the Jedi way as a Jedi Knight to just stand still because this is balance. Like, if I get involved, I'll make it worse. Which I like the message. What's funny though, so she's like, this is wrong. So she grabs her lightsaber and she just books it, runs as fast as she can to this village. Burst through like the walls and stuff like that, and all the people are actually having a celebration. And she was duped. He just wanted to see how she would react. He made that all up. Yeah. He knew what was going on. And so he's saying, like, this is the danger of the Jedi and the Sith. So that you think you know the way, and you're using the Force to do what you think is the way of like how things should be. And that's what he's learned. He's saying that, like, it's better if we don't get involved. Maybe we should never have been, kind of thing. So that's his struggle. Of course, cool. He can't, because he tries to burn the tree, and he can't, and Yoda does instead. But, you know, all this. And so it was a cool scene. I don't know. I liked it, but nothing. I can see why it was cut, too, I guess.
No, that is cool. It kind of brings back sort of the message of the Jedi. We always think of the Jedi as the good guys, but, again, it's sometimes hard to know who's a good guy and who's a bad guy, like whose philosophy is actually correct, you know.
Yeah. Mark Campbell's acting is so good too when he's talking to, when he's giving his first lesson to Rey and stuff like that, and reach out, and it's funny when she reaches out and he's like, "Can you feel
How'd you feel about that, Dave?"
That one wasn't too bad.
I like that.
That one I didn't mind. But then, like, I don't know, her speech was a little too perfect when she's like, "Close your eyes and tell me what you see." And then all of a sudden she does this long dialogue that is the perfect explanation of the Force, which it was good, but
for somebody who's been living in a dirt junkyard for her
whole life. Yeah, I'm like, that's a little on the nose, but like,
that's like the only complaint I have with Rey is that she's a little too beautiful and sophisticated.
I do like her character, but like things, I don't know. You were saying
she's
like
perfect. That's things the came complaint people have.
Things came easy for the Force for, I guess, Luke did have training, though, but, like, she has, like, no training, and she can swing a lightsaber, which is, like, when she was practicing on the beach there, it looked like somebody playing Beat Saber or something. Like, I'm like, you have no training, you're just swinging a stick around in the air.
But, well, that's not true.
She's
that's
good
not
with
true.
The, she's good with the no, staff, no, no. though, if I you guess.
Yeah, if you watch The Force Awakens, she can hold her own. Like, she's never concerned, and
sure.
Like,
actually, you yeah, that's to protect true. You.
And she's like, I'm good. I've been living in a very rough area my whole life. So that transition makes sense. Like, Luke Skywalker can fucking talk to Obi-Wan Kenobi through the Force at the end of Force A New Hope, where we just saw, like, Obi-Wan Kenobi could not talk to Qui-Gon the whole series, you know, until the very end. Spoilers.
Well, we do know that Rey is special. Even Luke says, like, "I haven't seen this much raw power since Kylo Ren," you know? So, like, clearly she has a lot of power, and she's very in tune with the Force. And she kind of has been her whole life. She's known there's been this thing inside of her that she didn't quite know how to
She's a Palpatine.
Explain. Yeah, exactly.
Which is weird watching it now, because I have not watched this movie in a long time. And probably since I've watched 9, honestly, I'm trying to think about it.
I put that out of my brain.
It would be so much better if they just stuck with this. Kylo says, your parents were nobody. They should have just stuck with that.
Yeah.
Like, well, that was the message to this movie. Like,
exactly.
It's always the same family. I don't know. This movie, it was supposed to, like, the broom boy, like, her being a nobody. You don't have to be somebody special to be something special in this movie. Like, you can be a nobody. You can be anybody. Anybody can be special.
And then they completely reverted or retconned that in the next movie.
It's so weird. Like, I liked... Yeah, I thought Rose was good in this. Finn was great in it. The one person that annoyed me was Holdo, the token white lady.
I don't get the hate on her either.
I didn't mind
her. I didn't hate her. It's just
Laura Dern shows up in a Star Wars movie and we have an issue. Like,
why do I give two squirts of piss about?
You don't have to care about her.
It should be no.
Did what you care about Obi-Wan Kenobi in A New Hope when he first met him? No, he's just like an old hermit.
Yeah, and he didn't. About. Oh, I guess he did die that movie too. It's true. But her, like, it's just, she's just an admiral. In my mind, what they should have done is it's a wasted opportunity to, like, you have Admiral Akbar in this movie, who's been around since the beginning.
They did Admiral Akbar dirty.
They did
him fucking dirty.
They should have killed Holdo.
That is my one complaint with this movie.
Let Akbar take over instead of Holdo and let him get the heroes.
They didn't even show Admiral Akbar die on screen.
They did. He's
death.
In the back.
Sort of.
He gets sucked out.
But
yeah.
They did him fucking. They did him dirty, real dirty.
I agree with that. He deserved a better death.
But you
know, anyways, the Holdo character is fine with me. Like I get that. I thought she was. See, the thing
she's
is,
okay.
Like, when you know the story, but she made the right call.
Mm-hmm.
Right, like just trust me. You're.
Well, she had a plan. Yeah, and
I am away. I outrank you. I'm not telling everybody our idea because what we're gonna do is actually kind of fucking risky, which is all she wanted to do, and everybody would have survived. Here's the thing. This is like, I actually like this. Like people complain about Canto Bight not being like meaningful, but I actually think it does. It means that these young people should have listened to the elders in this movie because, like, okay. If they stuck to the plan, if Poe would have just calmed down and trusted them, they would have eventually made it to that planet, and their big ship would have kept going, and that's what the First Order was chasing after, right? And everybody would have hit on Kate? Crate,
yeah. Yeah, the whole reason
they
know about it was from
and they would have just gone by, and then they could send out their signal and gotten help. But what? No. They get interrupted, and now everything's panic mode. So now she's like, listen, now the plan I got to do is to do this, but you fucked up, and now Poe's with, like, a no-name thief codebreaker guy who just ratted out our whole plan, and now all these people are getting killed off because of you guys. We would all live if nobody...
Okay.
And that's the thing. Like, nobody respects. Like Leia says in the very beginning of the movie, don't do it, Poe. Poe's like, this is our chance to take a dreadnought. And he turns the comm off and goes and attacks. It looks cool. It shows off how awesome he is. But, like, at what cost? And she's like, now we lost so much of our military.
Which makes no sense.
All of our bombers.
Don't bring this up again.
Nope, Holdo doesn't tell anybody her plan. She's got her own secret little plan.
She told other people, just not Poe.
Yeah, she told the need to knows. Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
And everybody else is... out on the
military,
ship,
bro.
They're over on Snoke ship or whatever. How does a random codebreaker who has no visibility into it, has no visibility out a window, can't do anything? How does he know Holdo's secret
Finn and
plan?
Finn and
because
Rose told them.
Yeah,
they,
and
they
po
don't
was,
know.
Poe was talking. No. There was a scene. They're on their way to Snoke ship, and Poe calls in. And says, "All right, guys, what's going on?" And they said. All right, because like he tells Holdo's plan is to get everybody to escape to that planet. He says it.
Oh, they say it in there?
The dude's right there. That's when he does his little. That's when he takes the necklace from Rose. That's the scene.
Didn't
he
see sees him
it.
In
he
the
hears
venom.
It. He's an opportunist. That's what he's trying to say. Yep. So you got to.
I saw that scene.
Good
I'm like,
bad.
What the? How the fuck does this random codebreaker know? Like,
I mean,
secret plan.
If they didn't get caught, they wouldn't. He wouldn't have never ratted them out because he was.
That makes sense though.
He had
makes more sense.
He was in it for himself. Yeah.
And think about it. This goes back to like the parallels of like Jedi versus Sith, right? If we would just not get involved with our use of the Force, Jedi and Sith, then the Force will just balance out and do its own thing because it's going to do its own thing, right? That's what he's saying. And then you have that Codebreaker guy saying the same thing, like Rebels or Resistance or First Order or whatever, like it doesn't matter like what side, like they're good people are gonna just gonna make deals, like this is the world we're in. He's like in the middle, right.
You blow them up, like, they blow you up.
It's a really good scene when
makes it better
going through the like the ship log of all, you know, the guy's ship they stole, when they're like, oh yeah, this weapons dealer, he sold weapons to the First Order, and then they're scrolling through and they see an X-Wing. Oh, turns out they sold weapons to the Resistance as well. So it's like,
it's not the Resistance, know, it's the Galactic sides. Republic.
All there right, no stop, resistance. Stop, stop it. Anyways, what else?
So there, oh, how about did you like any of the nods, like when Luke got snuck? So like Chewie's like trying to eat like some porgs and he's having a moment like, oh, I shouldn't be eating these porgs, looking at these cute little things, and then you see Luke sneak on to the Millennium Falcon.
That was good.
I was just like, dude,
I didn't even
little R2 thing.
I didn't notice that.
Yeah, you see him sneaking in the background. He gets up on the ship, turns lights on, and then R2 like sees him and he starts yelling at him and stuff like that. And then he plays the video. I was just like, dude, I don't know. Like that shit.
That was good. That was one of the best parts of the, I don't know. You feel like it brings up the history. It brings up his reasons for coming back, but he should have never left, which is just silly. But that's a whole nother movie.
I think it would be boring if he didn't.
I like Kylo's arc throughout the movie where he goes.
This is a Kylo movie.
I never felt him as being Sith. I felt him as more being like a rebellious, whiny teenager, like in the beginning, but then towards the.
Well,
everything
in The Force Awakens, anyways, he was just trying to be Vader. He was just trying to imitate Vader and be like him.
Yeah.
He thinks, you know, he wanted to be as powerful as him. Yeah, exactly.
Parents are generals from like
grandfather guide me before. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and Luke Skywalker, the only Jedi left, is training him. Mm-hmm. Like it's like a celebrity having a kid that's like a musician. It's like, all right, their kid's probably gonna get into music, you know. There's a lot of pressure on him, you know. That's the whole thing about Ben. It's just like, I want to be a nobody, you know, because like Rey is a nobody, he's jealous, like that's his thing, like that's the whole drive. It's like he's trying to carve it out and he tries to like do what Snoke says, I killed my dad, dude. Yeah, but it kind of like, you almost got your ass kicked by like a no-name girl with a lightsaber, like what's going on there, you know.
I think his nobody speeches to Rey though is like him trying to, it's not him actually knowing anything, it's him just trying to break her down and get to join him, really. But
He's a douchebag he's a bad guy, he's not he's trying to manipulate her for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
but he's also being very open and fresh at the same time.
Yeah,
that's, but I think Adam Driver is a good actor, so he pulls it off.
Oh yeah, very
his
very
facial
good performance.
Performances. Like, dude, when Rey shows up to try to convert Kylo, he's like, nope, we're going to see Snoke, and she's like, you're gonna turn. He's like, no, you're gonna turn, and that whole shot, like, yeah, the choreography and that fighting scene has some issues that people have exposed. Okay, go watch like Force Awakens, or I'm sorry, go watch A New Hope's like saber battles. Like, I get it. Like, I don't know. Like, maybe it should be better. I don't know. Whatever.
It was still, isn't it?
But it looks cool.
I liked it.
Very cool looking battle.
Yeah, and they do some unique shit with the lightsaber too, like that you don't really see them normally.
Catches it.
Yep,
I love that. Sweet.
Turns it on.
She throws, I think somebody gets like their head thrown into the thing and all the red curtains like burn up. And then for like the rest of the fight, you have like this particle effects of things raining down.
It's beautiful.
It is really such a good looking movie. I thought the red guys kind of felt like Power Rangers, how everybody has like their own specific weapon. And I'm going to do this ninja stuff before I actually like attack
you.
It's
two or three weapons. There's like, you have the dagger guys or whatever they are, the short swords.
It's like the chain.
You have the guys with
like
the
spears,
sword that
the
turns
vibro
into
blades.
The blade,
the spear things,
spears. Yeah, and then like the sword that can also turn into a Morning Star or whatever.
That was a sweet fight, though.
Made it more interesting. Yeah,
shows how nasty Kylo is, though, because he fucks like he's fighting three of those guys at a time.
He's like a medieval knight with his armor off. I loved it.
No, it's cool. It's awesome.
It's very cool.
He's got a very raw fighting style, though, where he's like,
yeah, that's what I love about it.
Very visceral.
Mm-hmm. He puts a lot of emotion behind his fighting.
But what's cool about, like, while that's going on, though, there's, like, all this climax of, like, you know, like, all the other story arcs are coming together. Because I think that's when the lightsaber's being, like, kind of pulled apart, right? Right?
Yeah.
And then Haldo realizes she has to turn the ship around and just crash into the Snoke's ship. And then the music is, like, building up. It's, like, fucking epic as hell. And then all of a sudden she just hits the thing and shoots through and...
I think that when that happens, that's one of the like the coolest scenes I've seen in a movie theater. Like when I saw that in theaters, like I was like the music cuts out. It was completely silent in the theater. Yeah, it was amazing. Like that scene just blew my mind the first time I saw it.
Dave's like,
I hated it. So,
it was cool to see.
What could a robot do instead of her?
Again, it was another...
Well, that's another thing. There you go. We again, don't have remote controls.
It was cool that they did something different.
Yeah.
Like, who would think to, you know, turn a ship around and put it in hyperspace take out a fucking
ship,
dreadnought
your biggest
and Star
ship.
Destroyers? Yeah. And like, whatever. Fuck all the Dave's, the stuff you were mentioning before. Like, oh, you can't do that anymore to put a ship in hyperdrive because it won't let you if there's an obstacle in the way. But
no, literal directors have gone back and like said,
well,
that it was like
care.
A one
this
in
is
a
cool fucking scene.
Can she override it manually though? Like, is that the whole point of her? Like, does
probably.
She have like a key that lets her have complete control? Like, she's an admiral, she's not like a janitor.
Mm-hmm.
Like, she's like, I'm going down with the ship, like, I got this, I can do this.
Yep,
like it makes I didn't even think about that shit when I watched it. I was like, this is fucking cool. Like, she cares so much that she's like, I will fucking stay and take the ship out in the coolest fucking fashion.
Mm-hmm.
And then Ryan Johnson does an incredible like 5 minutes of build up, climax, and like that. And then it leaves you wondering, okay, Snoke's dead. Kylo and Rey were just arguing over about like a lightsaber and stuff like that. You know, like what happens next? Mm-hmm. And then we still have to go to Crait and have a fucking epic battle there with Luke. Showing up, dude. It is
so
cool.
After Rey kind of denies Kylo, you know, like she doesn't want to join him in whatever plan he has.
It's that's probably not a good one.
No. That's where he does his turn, and he, you know, he kind of takes
please.
Over for Snoke. Yeah,
shows that
I know,
vulnerability.
I like that he says please.
Yeah,
like, he's like, come with me, mm-hmm. please. And that was a nice touch to the writing. Because, like, it shows that he's still vulnerable. Because he couldn't kill his mom earlier in the movie. Like, he didn't do it.
Nope, couldn't
Two
pull
random
the trigger.
Pilots did it, you know? So there's still conflict in him.
I want to see him be more scarred. You could tell that he was still conflicted. A lot of the Sith and Star Wars lore have, like, really pale skin or the red eyes or whatever like that. That's how I kind of figured that, I don't know, throughout it, you see, like, his scars. When you get the shirtless Kylo scene, you get to see that. Because they moved his scars from Force Awakens to this movie, where it's like more down and you can kind of see it come across his shoulder mm-hmm. as well, which was kind of cool to see because he seems more Sithy, I guess. But I guess towards the end of the movie, there's not really a good line to him anymore. I don't know. You see the hope
he's
after Rey kind of ditches him. He's like, he's all in. He's pot committed.
I was gonna say once they get onto Crait, which is beautiful, by the way. I love like the contrast between the white and the red salt and everything.
Stunning,
looks so cool.
Absolutely stunning.
That's
and it's very
and, like there's like a really cool shot of Leia, like
yeah.
her eyes just gazing her, like, out, just like I fucking love that shot, dude.
She just
ominous. She just
randomly has this winter thing. It was a cool kind of, I don't know, costume or whatever.
It's like a wind guard. It's very windy on Crait.
It's a completely random and worthless costume change, but it looks cool. So put it in the movie, sure. Crait did look awesome. It's great level to play in Battlefront too. actually, but
yeah,
the mono sleds were kind of, it was like a growing point for Poe there, because, you know, the beginning of the movie, he's the fly boy that had to attack. He says, you start a battle, you end it. And then at the end, he's doing this little mini speeder run, and he's the one that calls it off and calls for them to retreat.
So that, he's a leader now.
Yeah, that's mm-hmm. the growth curve of Poe. I thought the Finn charging in and Rose saving him thing, or Rose saving him, was
Finn pretty should have stupid. Died.
Yeah,
Finn I thought have Finn's died. Arc was great up until, because he was running away. He just cared about himself and Rey in the beginning of the movie, and at the end of the movie, he's learned enough that he's so angry and on a high from like taking out Phasma and like escaping the he's like, I found purpose, I am willing to die. They should have killed him off. It would have sucked. But could you imagine if they killed him off instead of fucking Rose? I don't like that Rose comes out of nowhere and hits him and kisses him. I thought that was dumb. I don't know why they put that in there.
I mean,
I don't like the Canto Bite shit either.
Bringing up,
I just didn't like this part.
You guys don't like me bringing up logic into it, but like, he's like 10
there
feet.
There is no logic. It's Star Wars.
I know. Yeah, Obi-Wan Kenobi. There has to be Kenobi. Luke Skywalker lives where his dad grew up. Yeah. And like, stop. Like, this it's all over the fucking
place. Rose can't catch up in time to Ram. He's like, he's on a death course heading into the laser. Yeah. Everybody else is running away, and I don't know how in hell she gets up in front of and rams him to the side without getting shot, and then they both kiss, and then they get back to the base without getting shot by
Darth Vader survive the Millennium Falcon shooting him from behind? Because every other fucking TIE fighter gets shot by that thing, blows up instantly. But when Darth Vader gets hit, he gets spun out in outer space and safer later. Yeah, like, give me a fucking break. It's plot armor.
They hit his wing.
It's just it's movie. It's fantasy. It's not science fiction.
He's an advanced TIE fighter. His TIE fighter has the pointy wings.
Okay. I'm sure he used the force to protect it. I don't know. It's just like, watch 4, 5, and 6 because there's bad shit in that too.
I agree there that Finn should have died. I think it would have made his arc more meaningful because, I mean, his arc for the rest of the series, you know, with episode 9.
It's just because he has nothing in the next
There's
movie.
Nothing. Yeah, exactly.
That's so insane. So that's frustrating.
He would have went out there as a hero, or he would have just made a useless sacrifice, and that kind of would have been another lesson in the movie. You know, like,
don't be like
making
that.
These sacrifices when you don't have to. You know, just do the smart thing. But yeah, and then we get to the force projection with Luke.
Dude, when Luke shows up, that music kicks in, and like. Oh, dude, that's a killer song. It's like building up. And he walks in and he goes to Leia. I don't know how you felt about that scene, Dave, but like
the Leia thing was alright. It was
I get in tears, man.
Like Leia's face I don't know. They bring back all the old actors, and I mean they weren't great actors back in the day either, but they didn't get any better with old age. But it was a nice goodbye between the brother and sister, you know.
Oh man.
He gives the dice over, mm-hmm. which is weird because it's a force projection and she's holding dice in her hand.
He can do that. Don't worry about it, Dave.
I'm saying Kylo can't stab through Luke as a force projection, but he can hand over the dice.
He can do what he wants with force.
Well then, guess what? Yoda should have just appeared as a force ghost and just flicked his finger and shot Snoke with lightning, and this whole movie would have never happened.
I think Yoda taking out Snoke.
Well, this is the first. Well, this Yoda's is the first dead, movie though. Where you see a Force ghost have an effect on the world.
But
which is
but he's
what
not
I'm
a
saying.
Force ghost. It's a Force projection.
Yeah.
It's not.
Yeah, it's
different.
Force projection.
I'm talking about Yoda.
Oh,
when he burns the tree and he flicks his finger and causes lightning to strike the tree, and like this is the first time we've ever seen a Force ghost have an effect in the real world. Which is
force? We don't know the rules of the force. That's where I don't take any umbrage with anything that happens with the force,
but then,
related to the force in this movie, because there's no rules.
If you introduce that rule, they introduce that rule into it where a force ghost can't like they.
What's the rule? Where do they never explore that? But there's no rule saying force ghosts cannot.
Well, no. Before
the weather.
Before all we knew was force ghosts just appear and they talk to you. They give you sage wisdom and they go on their merry way.
Yeah.
Now, in this movie, all of a sudden, Force ghosts can flick their finger and cause lightning to strike trees and have an effect in the real world.
And it's a sacred island, dude. Sure. Like, it's a very, very, very Force-sensitive island. Sure. Like, it's like where the sacred texts are. Like, it's like I think you're just...
But why doesn't Yoda do that somewhere else? Why doesn't he...
Why is Yoda blown away by a flashlight in Empire Strikes Back? Like, what the fuck am I going to title this episode of this podcast? This is
like Dave's a cranky old man. I don't know.
It's just like Dave... Like, Last Jedi breaks Dave's brain on Star Wars. Like, it's like, like this movie, for some reason, gets you get the magnifying glass out for this movie, but you don't give a fuck about 4, 5, and 6 doing silly shit, dude. Like, it's...
Like, Han Solo is kinda...
pointless in episode 6. He's a pointless character in 6. He's great in 4. He's incredible in 5. Pointless in 6.
He leads he takes on the shield deflectors in 6. Anybody could have done that.
He's just comic relief. He's just bebopping around on that movie. He's just like upset that like Leia is like into like Luke for some reason. He just doesn't know that they're brother and sister yet. So it's just this movie, I feel like you're like, just you want to have an issue with it, so you're just looking at for it's, things to I can't not like see, instead of just
I can't see past them. Like every like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 like I watch all those movies, I see CG, I see everything. There's a logical reason for things in those, and some for some reason in this, I think it is because they took so many risks and they kind of shook the bag of Star Wars up and they're like, well, maybe we can do this, maybe we can do that, and it kind of...
Why do we have to have the same old formula in Star Wars, though? Would you want a mirror image of Empire Strikes Back, just like they did with The Force Awakens?
No, that's not. That's why Force Awakens isn't that great of a movie, is because we already told that movie. We already saw that story.
Skip. We're going to ignore that comment.
Sorry, guys.
Yeah, it is a great movie.
It was good. No, it was good, but it was just... It was a repeat of the other movie.
It did exactly what it needed to do to get us back into Star Wars after so many years of hiatus.
I think Starkiller was I didn't like that. I was like, that's kind of dumb. We already fucking had two of these fucking things. Like, do we really need to do that? But I like the rest of that
movie.
They
should have taken more from the expanded universe. They had, I don't know, some planetary base that would actually shoot suns and make suns go supernova. Like, come up with something like it doesn't...
Oh, but that's logical.
Yeah, it is. It's perfectly logical. Okay. You shoot a laser into a ball of, you know,
Dave,
a ball of
does
gas
it bother
that's
you that these humanoids up. Can just go to any planet and just naturally breathe the air? Hey, we're going to this planet.
Oh,
with trees and water. You'll be fine. Don't worry
about
bacteria.
Well, now that you say it, it does. No, but Han's got those breath masks.
The escape pods have the same gravity. How about a ship that just got zapped in half?
There's no logic in Star Wars.
There's no gravity issues.
Paige is laying down, the ship's wide open in the vacuum of space, and she's, you know, completely fine. Like, there's so many instances
where... When the ships blow up, they fall down in outer space.
Right.
It's ridiculous.
They also make booms.
There's sound in space. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. That's fine, whatever.
Until Haldo does like an incredible thing where they actually showed probably what really happened with...
Well, that's the thing, is that if Haldo can do it, then like they should have done that on all of the Death Stars. They should have done that over and over.
So start
and
sending
over
their biggest ships.
Their most valuable resource.
Build these things and shoot them at that thing.
You build a big fucking hammer and you put a jet engine on it and you remote control it and you just smash it into shit. That's what this movie proves, is that you could just do that throughout the galaxy.
We're getting crazy now. Like,
just take a battering ram and put a hyperdrive on it and there you go. There's your ship.
All right. Anywho, Kylo is furious that Luke Skywalker is showing up.
This was good.
Right? And that was just my quote, which is just like, I want every gun that we have to shoot
more
at that man.
More.
Holy shit, dude.
That was great.
I want every gun we have to fire on that man. Do it.
More! More! That's enough!
Do you think you got him?
Now, if we're ready to get moving, we can finish this.
Sir?
And it's cool because it looks like I love this, just the visuals. Luke literally makes fun of like Rey in the beginning, like, "What do you want me to do? Grab my laser sword and just take on the whole First
laser
Order?"
Sword.
Like,
don't say laser sword. Come on.
He says it.
I know
he says it. He says it mockingly, it, though. I think it's a good like point that he's making.
And I'm sorry, Dave, but like it was, I think, originally supposed to be called a laser sword until they changed it to lightsaber later on. Sure. But in the first movie, it almost was called.
He's
a laser
purposely
sword.
Calling it the wrong name to meta. Degrade it. Yeah. And that too, yeah.
And I think it's just like a nod to us.
Star Wars.
Like, I think people are upset. Oh my god! So I think people are upset that like where's Luke? I know he's like going on like 70 years old, but like he can still like zip around and fight like Kylo Ren. Like, so like when he says that, he's like, people like to the franchise, like, and she's and Rey is saying the line like, "You're I need to find you and save us." Old man.
Episode 4, 5, and 6 set the foundation that Luke will do anything to save his friends and family.
When he's a 20-year-old. Mm-hmm.
Listen, 10 years, a couple years go by, he builds his Jedi Academy, his little
PTSD.
His nephew has his little thing, and he's just like, fuck this. I don't care about my friends or family anymore. I'm going to go hide on this rock
and
die.
I just said, he's supposed to be just like the most boring character who doesn't have any... character arc. He's just the same thing throughout. Like,
if he
that's
cared
a cartoon
about
character,
his friends,
bro. That's Homer
family.
Simpson.
He would have done
the last
something.
30 years. No, the, I'm just saying. Luke is allowed to be not the same person he was 40, 50, 60 years ago.
Sure, I mean
he's allowed to change.
That's what I was saying. Well,
he is allowed.
It would have been boring for Luke's. It would have been boring for Luke's character arc if that would have happened, and then Rey would have had no character arc if that also happened.
Well, who's to say that Rey and Luke couldn't go on adventures?
Cool.
Together, they go on adventures together.
I know.
Get Kylo back.
So what do you? What,
Luke and Rey fight Kylo and take him out.
Oh my god!
See,
that's like fan fiction.
That sounds cool.
Sounds boring. It sounds
exactly
boring.
This sounds like Obi-Wan.
I like that Luke showed up. He's like, I'm not gonna fight you.
Obi-Wan and Anakin, Master Padawan.
If you want
going
that, watch. If you want that, watch the Clone Wars because that's exactly what the Clone Wars is. It's Anakin and Obi-Wan going on adventures.
Yeah.
So we already have that.
I like Luke. I like Rey. Just I wanted some buddy cop stuff going on. Like even. Like we were just talking about the more scene or whatever. Like right after that, like you got Hux. Hux is getting smacked.
Don't you think you've done enough or shot enough?
Oh god!
He throws him again. Like that's good. That was the kind of witty, funny humor that I liked in this movie. But like BB-8 shooting out quarters, no, that's not funny. But like in universe stuff that happens
it's
between
like a
2-second
gag.
No, they're all over. They're all over this movie, but I thought that was funny.
All the complaint that we have done on this episode, and we didn't even touch Canto Bite, and it's probably for good reason.
I don't mind
Canto
Bite.
Canto
Bite's
fine. I don't even.
I honestly
I don't
blown
think
away
it
people
needs
had
to,
an issue with it.
Yeah, I don't think we even need to talk about it because it's not amazing, but it's not.
Lesson learned. It's a lesson learned. It's to drive character.
Yeah.
You know, it's to say that you guys really got to stick to the plan.
Well,
idiots.
That, and then it, you know, comes around at the end with like, you know, there's still hope out in the galaxy with the broom kid.
Broom boy.
From Canto Bite. Yeah, broom boy.
That kid can't act, by the way. He doesn't say, like, any lines, and it's just, like, the way he, like, moves and says, like, a couple words, I guess. But
the stampede scene was
We all know how you feel about kid actors.
The stampede scene is kind of dumb, but I did I did like the world, but, like, you can't just jump on a horse and make it headbutt its way through a solid wall and just, like, trample through a thing. Like, that was a little weird, but in general, I just like the world
alien
and the casino.
Horses.
Yeah, alien.
Get over it.
They're like 8 feet tall too, so maybe they.
It's commentary on our. It's on our country.
Maybe
it's
they
on
don't.
Our world or whatever. You know, arms dealers are just fucking going to shady places, and
they don't give a shit. They just want to make
pretty
money
on the outside.
Yeah, exactly. It's all about money.
Yeah, I'll say this. I think this is. I can see why people take issue with it. I don't, but I will recognize that it's the weaker part of the storytelling. I don't think there's any chemistry between Rose and Finn. Not that I didn't want there to be, but like when she kisses him at the end, it just came out of fucking nowhere. Finn was instantly attracted to Rey in the Force Awakens.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that they should have gone together. Like, why can't Finn be with Rey? Like, why do they got to be friends? Like, I think it would make an interesting story.
He got friend zoned.
Yeah, he did. And, like, and then Rose popping in and, like, being an Asian character, which is fine. And it's a shame that people were mean to her. But, like, I don't know. Like, did we want to do this? Like, I felt like it was forced. I would rather that there was an actual relationship between Finn and Rey.
Yeah, whatever.
Or it's just me shipping people. Even if they're going to stay,
or like continue it in the next movie, like that both of them so kind of disappeared in the next movie too.
You know, like I don't know. Yeah, there's something you could have done very emotional at the end, where like when Finn throws his life away, maybe Rey was there with Chewie before instead of just showing up with the Falcon and saving everybody, or more or less taking out other ships. But they land and they're I don't know. They needed time, and Finn second that would have been so much. You know, like I love you. Let me the Force be with you or something. And he fucking dies. It would have been fucking epic. Like,
Finn's whole arc was squandered. I think they had potential to make him good and to have him go out as like a hero and make us care about his arc, but they just dragged it out for the last movie. I think he was a good character that they squandered a little bit.
That's cool though, because he was originator the traitor aspect of a stormtrooper that realizes that you know. Empire or First Order is kind of fucked up, and they're, you know, they're not the nice guys, but could have taken him other places. He was cool. I don't think he's coming back to Star Wars either. I saw John Boyega
he was not happy with how they treated Finn and treated him.
My personal take on that is that he probably has his entourage of people, you know, like you're a known name. You have the world's your oyster. Be careful of the movie you did. And he's probably fuck that shit. I'm not going to do it. But I think time's going to go by, and I think people are going to Star Wars means a lot to a lot of people. There's a lot of people out there who they live and breathe Star Wars. And I don't need to get into the details of who those people are, but you can kind of picture those people who are literally so they don't care about the bullshit. They just take it as is and they love it. Right. And I think over time, Hayden Christensen probably said the same thing. I'm not going back to that fucking thing. Fuck that shit. And he came back and people gave him big open arms. Time goes by. Like, people learn. Like, there's a toxic crew around Star Wars. I don't know why people have to be so mean. But I think there's enough love in the franchise that will win him over. And I think he'll come back because I think he deserves at least a movie. If we can make a movie about Solo... We can make a movie about fucking the guy that's was that guy from Rogue One that's getting his own movie or TV series?
Andor,
yeah. Mm-hmm. Right? If he can get a fucking show like Finn, like you're telling me that like
Finn and Poe, like you know, buddies.
Finn and Poe, do it. Yeah,
send them across. Please, we got it.
That was sweet. The only good thing about Episode 9 was like the them two the together Finn and in the Poe beginning
bouncing off each other. Yeah, they're really good together.
Please give us a show. Like, I don't think he's done. I think he's just going through the emotions right now because I think it's hard to be in Star Wars. I think it's hard to be in Star Wars.
Such
I
mean, a critical eye Hamill. When you're.
He wasn't in many that, movies after Star Wars.
And like, yeah, there are too many toxic Star Wars fans on the internet.
Hey,
that
no.
will just. I'm not. No, I'm not. Don't. There's much worse people than you, Dave.
Dave's not toxic. No, Dave's a grumpy old man. He's, that was, I know. Like, yeah. What he's
no,
seen
I'm
before.
Just opinionated that, about you know some things I think fit in the galaxy. Some things I don't think make sense. Like, I'm thinking from a logical point of view from I don't know, you're not supposed to put logic into sci-fi or any bullshit like that, but like I don't know,
yeah,
some things just didn't make sense for me in this movie, and I know it's because they took a lot of risks and we're switching directors and we
don't
have
give this movie out of 10, Dave. I'm curious.
I mean, it's
a 4.
It's so good to look at, like, so I gotta give it some credit because like
you've if been I, nothing but negative on this whole movie, if, this whole conversation.
No, I have
so I
not.
I can't imagine
I have
it
not.
Over 5.
There are some comedic elements that work. I like the Finn stuff. I like the Poe stuff. It's all right. I mean, some of that stuff goes back and forth. The Luke and Rey stuff is good. The visual elements of the story are really good. It'd probably be like a 6. 5.5, 6.
That's crazy. I give this movie a 9.
Just because, I mean, if I watch it, if I turn off my brain and I'm not listening to it and not paying it, I'm just watching it, it gets like an 8 or a 9. But
that's what I'm saying. You got to look at this as a standalone. Forget all, everything you know, not forget everything you know about Star Wars.
I can't.
Ignore all the fucking whatever bullshit rules that are set up in the rest of the universe and just kind of think of it.
You do have to lose a lot of emotional baggage that you carry from, like,
that's what
who
I'm
saying. Was Luke before and
exactly,
you know, all that kind of crap. And that's all the stuff that
who
I
was
can't...
Obi-Wan Kenobi before, who was Anakin before. That's the whole thing. That's the theme of Star Wars, that these fuckers, the Force being a popular Jedi, being a legend. He even calls out, like, this is what a legend is. It's not all it cracks up to be, right? And, like, that's what it's about. It's just like you hit this high, you think you represent something, and then you fail.
Mm-hmm.
What do you do?
You realize
with that
how
failure?
Much pressure was you on low. Him? Yeah, everyone idolized him as this hero of the Republic.
Look
like
at Kylo,
you said, Dave,
same thing.
And he failed, and now he doesn't think everyone will look at him the same. And he lost, I think the big thing is he lost faith in himself, you know? Like, he didn't believe in himself anymore, so why should anybody else believe in him?
He's got Grogu with him back then, you know?
No, he doesn't. And the good... So here's another thing. When the good guys, when the Jedi fail, all right, they give up and they just hang their heads low and they go in hiding. But, like, when a bad guy fails, like Anakin or Kylo, when they give in being a Jedi, they fail being a Jedi and they give in to the dark side, they don't go and hide. They do the opposite. They become top dog, aggressive, and hunt. It's actually very cool how that works out. So it's like when you give in to the dark side and you fail as a Jedi, you go and be like, all right, I'm going to take over the world and I will bring balance. I'm going to do it my way. All right? Anakin's like, yeah, I'll take out the Emperor. You're like, with my empire. And Obi-Wan's like, your empire? Same thing with Kylo. It's just like, yo, when I take out, well, like, no, that Snoke's dead. Like, Rey, like, our way. Fuck the Jedi. Fuck the Sith. This is, I will do it. It's the thing. Darth Vader said this in, like, in what, 5, right? We'll take out the Emperor. Maybe it's 6. I'm sorry. It might be 6.
Rule the galaxy
we'll
is
the
father
Emperor.
And son.
It's father and son. It's like a common theme. This movie's doing the same thing. We've seen this before. And I think it's beautiful. And I think this is, like, this movie feels so Star Wars to me. That it's just like, I don't know, whatever. I mean, like, I get the frustration people have, but every time I see it, I just see the theme. I think Rian Johnson may have gone a little too far, a little on the nose with some things. For me, it's okay, but I can see how it rubs people the wrong way. And I walk out of this movie every time, like, yeah, it just feels right. It feels fresh, feels different, and I'm glad that they made the decisions they did.
But I will say, I went back after I finished this movie last night, I put on Empire Strikes Back for a little bit. I didn't watch the whole thing, but I just put it on and I'm like, wow, this movie's really fucking good.
Like, that one was another one of the more visually appealing movies. I think even out of the original trilogy, I think Empire is like the best looking of them.
Yeah. Like, I was skipping around a little bit and watching like specific scenes and I'm like, man, this is really good. But I still, it trips me out every time I watch this movie that Poe and Rey don't actually meet for the first time until the end of this movie.
Yeah.
We see so much of those two characters throughout The Force Awakens and this movie, and then you don't realize that Poe and Rey have never met. And it's, I don't know, it trips me out every time.
That's like, a nice little touch, though.
No, that is cool. And something I noticed at the end, they don't follow up with this at all. They don't follow up with anything in Episode 9 from this movie, but Rey has the Jedi texts at the end. There's a little scene where they're in in the drawer in the Falcon.
Finn is looking for a blanket to put on Rose, and his hands go right over the books.
Yep. I never noticed that until I watched it again last night. But I thought that was pretty interesting. But they don't follow up on that at all, so what does it really mean? Or I don't know. If maybe she, in between the movies,
the Jedi
she
aren't
studies.
Done. Like, they give... Luke gives that speech where he's like, and I am not the last Jedi, and then they cut over to Rey.
That's the whole... Yep.
Which is fine. And I don't mind.
Which is also
the broom boy.
Who is the last Jedi?
I think that's the point. There isn't one. I think we're supposed to think it's Luke, but then, you know.
Right. You go into the movie. I love it. You go into the movie thinking, who's the last Jedi? Well, it's Luke. But no, it's Luke. It's Rey. It's Kylo. In 9, he does turn back. He's still not giving up. He does go back at the end. He makes the right decision, you know, and he does what like Anakin did, but and it's Prune Boy. It's anybody. It's nobody. That's what's awesome about this story. Like, yes, the kid acting isn't the best, but I love that the end, like, that kid just like.
Fine.
And I like that, like, the kids like playing with toys, kind of talking about what we just saw. Like, this is about legends, like, you know, like the famous. Oh, you're this, you're that, and it's a commentary on this movie. It's just like, you're born into knowing that Star Wars is this thing, and you gotta watch them, and you gotta know that the first three are like amazing, and then they had like the prequels, and you have all those things here, and like. Everybody has like this story and stuff like that. Like, this is what I want my Luke to be. And it's crazy because like the movie comes out and holy shit, everybody was angry about what Luke became to be. They like, this is what I wanted him to be. And that was the whole point that I think they wrote about Luke, is he's not the same. He's not that legend anymore. He was, but then he failed. And like we talked about before. So
the only one that
to me, The Last Jedi is, it means it's anything.
The only thing that failed is that it took them so long to make the prequel, the sequel trilogy. Because if they would have made it 10 years earlier, they would have made it 15 years earlier. It would have been a completely different thing and probably been, I'm guessing, better.
Probably would have been better because you don't really get a Luke, Han, and Leia scene together in this. And that's just sad because fucking, I can't believe.
All three of them.
I can't believe.
Each one a main character.
Carrie Fisher passes away before this movie comes out. And they kill her in this movie, but then. She doesn't, and then she does her scene, you know. And I, to me, like, it's like almost poetic, right? That happened. It's sad that she passed away, but like, go figure.
It is weird to think about, because the whole time you're going into this movie, like, thinking that they're gonna kill her off because she died in real life, but then
and you see it happen in the show, and like, oh, that explains, okay.
Mm-hmm. And then,
but they even said that, like, no, we actually wrote none of that, like, her death. It has nothing to do with
no effect on that, right? Story. Yeah. They already had filmed that and wrapped that up by that time she died.
And I'll say it's a Luke and Leia movie too. Like, it's a Luke, Leia, Kylo movie. Like, it's a lot of characters in this movie, but like,
I mean, it's the Skywalker story. You know?
Yeah.
Some of them aged better than others. I thought, I don't know. Han was good in Force Awakens. Luke was good in this one. I think Leia's probably the weakest out of the three of them at this point.
But. Yeah, dude. There's nothing we can do about that. Yeah. Like, Carrie Fisher got into coke and she got old. And
her face doesn't move anymore.
It is what it is. Yeah, but like, whatever. Like, I go into this movie just happy that she's there.
Yeah. Right. It is cool that they did get everybody back.
There's nothing I can do about
eventually.
That. Yeah. So. And her acting is better in this than it was in The Force Awakens. I'll say that too. But
no, she did. She played a big part.
She had her, like, cockpit, Dave.
Yeah, that was a fucking stupid line. I just wanted to say cock in a Star Wars movie.
Let's wrap this up soon.
I'm not
done. We've been talking for an hour and a half.
One more.
Oh god.
All right, get it out.
If they are the Galactic Republic and they just got their planet blown up
again,
why does Rose have a secret decoder ring that's like, psst, hey, guess what? I'm part of the Republic. Blah, 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 blah. Look at Broom Boy. Makes no sense. Sorry, I'm done. What? Clock me out.
All right, I'm going to disregard that comment.
Clock me out.
I don't know. I kind of want to edit you out.
It makes no sense.
Let's wrap this shit up. I feel like we've said everything.
We didn't talk about Mary Poppins either, but that's all.
Just
it's fine.
It's fine.
It's not fine. It is not fine. You cannot
open
your eyes.
It doesn't ruin the movie for me. It doesn't ruin it for me. So
it ruins my experience.
I actually like it more than I did in the first time I saw it. I didn't like it, but this time I was like, actually, it's kind of growing on me, and I didn't think it would. Sorry,
whole
Dave.
Different story. I'm not even gonna start about that.
All right, let's shut it down,
please.
Let's shut it down. We've said a lot of stuff. I don't know.
We've never had an episode like this one before.
No,
Nomads of Positivity.
Yeah, you know what? If you like this conversation, if you like this style, let us know in Twitter, email, whatever. Just let us know.
I can be devil's advocate for anything. I can just argue for the sake of arguing if we want to.
I was going to say, I feel like we could have made this episode like 3 hours long if we really, really wanted to, but let's wrap up this part of the episode of our Last Jedi discussion, and let's relax a little bit, go into a nice game to close it out after all that
cleansing breath,
discussing, and we got it all out. So we'll be back. We'll be back with a game after this little commercial break.
We don't have commercials.
I know. We are back with a game to wrap this up. Such a long episode. I think we're going to do a short little game here. A game of Star Wars 20 questions. So this can be anything related to Star Wars. Could be a character, could be a video game, could be a movie, could be a planet, could be a book, could be a comic. Literally anything. So you guys will have 19 questions and a guess. Yes, to get the Star Wars thing that I am thinking of. But without further ado, let the questioning begin.
This is a different start, so we can kind of go in any direction here. Is this thing, whatever it is, referenced in a Star Wars feature film, like episode?
Do they
one
like
through
the
nine.
Thing that you are? Do they say that name or word?
Anywhere in 1 through 9. I'm not talking about Solo or any of those other ones.
I don't think so.
Interesting. Okay. Wicket. It's Wicket, Dave. They never say Wicket's name.
Technically, he's in Return of the Jedi, though.
But they don't say, "Hey, I'm Wicket." Hey, Wicket.
Well, you bought the toy.
Yeah,
I'm not 100% sure if they do. I don't think so.
All right, so it's not Luke, Leia. It's not like a character. It's not Death Star. It's not any. That's a good question, Dave.
That is a good question to narrow some stuff down.
So I mean, there's still a ton of stuff it could be. It could be from a TV show. It could be from one of the side movies. It could be from a comic. What are you thinking?
I don't know where to go from there.
Is this, we can narrow down what it is, technically.
Are you a character?
No.
Okay, so it's not a character. I mean, you could just pick like a random planet,
right?
Like
person, place.
I'm from. I picked Norbus 9. It was in one episode of the Clone Wars.
I wouldn't be that mean.
I mean, there are a lot of games we could head down that path. Is this?
Oh, I haven't been keeping track. This is gonna be question 3, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Is this a Star Wars video game?
Yes, it is.
Whoa. Okay. Whoa.
Well, that helps. Is it the best Star Wars video game? I'm just kidding.
Which one is that?
Well, we all know what one that is.
I think that could be debatable.
Jedi Power Battles for the PlayStation 1, of course.
That is a pretty
that fighting game from the 90s.
It was like a top down
Masters of Terras Kasi. Don't talk shit about that game. I like that game.
Pod Racer, that was a good game too.
I played that for a hot minute.
Well, he didn't answer the question, so
it is a Star Wars game. What question?
I was just saying, do you play as a Jedi in this game?
No.
Okay, so it's not Jedi Power Battles. Oh. So it's not that fighting game. It could be. I mean, there's those Academy games. There is the Shadows of the Empire games.
Dark Forces.
Yeah. There's some of the flying games. There's, you know, Squadrons or the, I forgot the one on 64. Rogue Squadron. That was a really good one.
Do you
fly a ship in this game?
I don't believe so.
Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4. That was
this five. Game come out before the year 2000?
No, it did not. It came out after the year 2000.
Okay.
Hmm.
I turned to the video game 20 questions with a Star Wars flair.
What came out after?
Did this game come out after the year 2009? Or did it come up? Yeah, you know what I'm asking. Did this come up after the year 2010?
Before the year 2010, yes.
Okay.
Before 2010, yes.
360, PS3, PS2, PC. What Star Wars game was out then? There was no movies. Well, that's not true.
Yeah, that's in the
Revenge of the
Sith. It's in the heyday of the prequels.
Yeah.
Prequel came out in 99, so it's probably 2 and 3.
My pod racing joke, it comes to mind because it was also around then.
But you're not, I guess.
Is this a game based on, well, no, it's a stupid question to ask if it's based off of the prequels. Clearly it is.
Should I get it?
How many questions do we have?
You've asked 7 questions.
Okay, is this game based on the prequel movies? Like, that, does it take place in that time, that era?
Oh, well, that's a different question.
All right, hold on. I don't want to throw you off. It's just that it looked like you didn't know how to answer that question, so... That's what I'm trying to say. Is this a prequels era based game?
Prequel era based game. I think the answer is yes, but I just want to.
Dave, what's confirm. That game that you're like commandos? You're like clone troopers or something.
The answer is yes to that.
Okay.
Question.
So Dave. Okay. So you know what I'm saying, Dave?
It's Republic first person. Commando? Is this a first person game?
Yes, it is.
Oh.
And you don't play as a Jedi.
It could be Republic Commando.
And that was right around between 2 and 3, I think. I could be wrong.
It was I think original Xbox maybe or.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And that was right in there. I don't know anything else in that era, really, that came out. Does not feature Jedi.
Is that exclusive to Xbox, Dave? Or no?
I don't think so.
Okay. What are you not playing positive. As? Republic Commandos. Like, what are those?
I think they're clone troopers, I believe. I haven't played that in such a long
Do you play as
time,
a clone but... trooper in this game?
Yes, you do.
Okay.
Oh.
All right, I'm feeling good about this, Dave.
I think you may have it on the
Is
the
this button. A squad-based game as well as it be, you know, it's like a first-person squad-based game?
I mean, yeah.
In that game you have people and you can order them around. That's why I'm asking that question. Like, can you command your fellow soldiers to do things?
Then yes, okay. You can.
I think it is. Dave.
Yeah, give it a roll.
Was this on Xbox? Just Xbox?
Yes, it was on Xbox.
All right. I'm going to keep burning through questions. Should I keep going, Dave? Or should I just ask?
We're on 12. I mean, if you want to narrow it down.
I feel like, I don't know. I don't know.
I don't know anything else really in that.
There's a first-person shooter where you play as a clone. But like, it could be Battlefront. Well, no, you can play as a Jedi in that,
You can play as Jedis in that, yeah. And you can fly ships. And it can't be... Yeah, I don't know. I think it's got to be.
All right, Eric. Unless... Is this Republic Commando? Is that what it's called? Republic Commando, Dave?
Republic Commando, yeah.
Republic Commando.
Is that your final answer?
Yeah.
I don't really know that. I know it's like we know the game. I just don't know the exact title.
It is. It's got to be Republic Commando.
That is correct. Yeah. Yes, it is Republic Commando.
Oh man!
Good job. I have never played this game, but I have heard very good things about it.
It's cool. Play it on Xbox. Your Xbox shit because it upgrades it.
It's been re-released recently. Last year, actually, it was re-released on the Switch and PlayStation.
Huh.
But yeah, it was originally released for Xbox and PC back in 2005. Developed by the old LucasArts. So yeah, good job. Got that in pretty quick. You narrowed it down to video games, and then it was smooth sailing.
I was hoping you were gonna pick something like Beskar armor or something like completely,
completely random. I wanted to make it quick. Yeah, I wanted to make it relatively quick. But once you got to video games, I'm like, okay, it's pretty easy. There's only so many Star Wars video games. So, but yeah, good job. It's late. Let's wrap this baby up. This was a lot of Star Wars talk. So I hope you enjoyed our conversation. It was a fun one to talk about. It was a fun one to argue about. Well, it was all in good spirits, though.
Absolutely.
We're all Star Wars fans here. We love Star Wars.
Everybody has their own flavor, and not everybody likes every flavor. So
that is a good
point. But everybody loves Star Wars.
That's right. All right. Well, I'll close us out here. If you want to follow us, you can follow us at Nomads of Fantasy on Twitter and Instagram. You can email us nomadsoffantasy@gmail.com. If you want to complain about our opinions on The Last Jedi, or if you want to agree with us on our opinions on The Last Jedi, you can visit us at thenomadsoffantasy.com for all your Nomad needs. You can join the Nomads of Fantasy Discord if you would like to chat more about us and yell at us about Star Wars. Nomadsoffantasy.com/Discord if you want to join there. But other than that, I think that's all I had. So let's wrap it up. As always, safe travels, Nomads, and may the Force be with you.
Reach out with your feelings. What do you see?
The island. Life. death and decay that feeds new life. Warmth, cold, peace, violence.
And between it all,
balance and energy. A force.
And inside you.
Inside me. That same force.
And this is the lesson. That force does not belong to the Jedi. To say that if the Jedi die, the light dies is vanity. Can you feel that?
There's something else. Beneath the island. A place. A dark place.
Balance. Powerful light, powerful darkness.
It's cold.
It's calling me.
Resist it, Rey. Rey!